September 14th, 2016. My name is Jason Bunn Parsons. I'm an autistic self-advocate who is kicking off a brand new project that I am seeking assistance on from anybody in the autism community who's willing to devote their time and energy into basically getting our facts straight. Basically, when I got diagnosed back in 2009, of course, I did all the research, I figured out what in the world this autism is, and it was either at that time or a couple years later when I was prepping for doing my first autism presentation at a conference that I organized at my then church, that I came across the actual article in which Dr. Connor coined the term autism. Okay, it's from a 1943 journal called The Hyperactive Child. Okay, and I was able to get that from the Simmons Foundation for Autism Research Institute. Okay, and so I downloaded it, and it's a rather lengthy document, I'm including a link to that that document so you can download it yourself from this organization. But anyway, so it's a really lengthy document, and as I mentioned in a number of other videos of mine, I'm not the world's greatest reader. My literacy skills are pretty subpar. I learn mostly by listening, and so that's one of the reasons why I like audiobooks. Okay, and so a couple years ago, a year or two ago, I came across this organization called LibriVox, which does public domain audio recordings of any document that's in the public domain, but it has to be confirmed in the public domain. Well, I assume because I was able to get this off the internet so freely that it must, be in public domain by now, because 1943. And so I contacted this organization, and they set me straight on the fact that, these copyrights last, a long time, even past the death of the author, which in case of Dr. Connor was 1981. Okay, and they will not do anything prior, or they will not do anything after, I believe, 1920, because the copyrights actually last that long. Maybe sometime actually you're in the 1920s. I forget exactly when, but anyways, yeah, so the copyright is assumed to still be in effect, and so they won't touch it unless, it can be confirmed absolutely that that Dr. Connor put this, in the public domain, maybe after he passed away or something. But in any case, so I contacted, Safari, I guess, if you want to read it like that, Simmons Foundation Autism Research Institute, in order to see if they could give me information clarifying this matter. And so I received a email back from one of their representatives, and she said, "My colleagues here believe that this paper should be public domain by now," which they're not copyright experts, obviously. LibriVox is all about copyright, so I'm taking LibriVox's word for it over these guys. But anyways, but suggested getting in touch with the American Psychiatric Association, which likely owns the copyright. I find that doubtful, actually. A recent article of ours also referenced that paper in the below way, in case it helps you. Let's see here. Reproduced without permission of the author for educational purposes only, according to the fair usage doctrine. I never heard of this before, and so I Googled fair usage doctrine, and I came across a page from the from copyright.gov. It's the U.S. Copyright Office, so go to the source when you want information, instead of going to talk to people about their opinion about what it probably means, you go to the actual source. And and I'm including the link to that page where it explains the fair usage doctrine and how everything works. But the thing is, I'm still a little bit confused, because it's talking about being able to use it for commentaries and stuff like that. But as far as actually releasing the entire document, I'm just confused about how this can be. And so anyways, and so I tried to contact the copyright office just now, before I started recording this video, and basically, that they said, "We're sorry, but due to high usage, all our operators are busy right now. Please call back at a time with less traffic," and then disconnected me. Okay, the least they could have done is put me on hold and give me the elevator music to put me to sleep while I'm waiting for one of their people to answer my call, but no, they just simply disconnected me. So I'm at a complete loss as far as how to go about doing this, making sure that that everything that I'm wanting to do is completely legal and above board. Because I'm not only one, the reason why I'm wanting to have the audio recording done is because I'm wanting to do a full-fledged commentary on the entire document, much like the in-depth commentaries that you see people doing on the Bible. Okay, that means I'm not just going to quote this little section, this little section, this little section. What it means is I want to give you the actual document, okay, and I'm going to go through that document, and commenting on this, on specific parts of that document, okay. And so that this is what I'm needing to figure out how to do is to make sure that it's that I go about this in a legal way and I don't get myself sued. Obviously, of course, anybody who tried to sue me isn't going to be able to get enough money to pay their lawyer's fees, because I ain't got any money. But still, it's just a matter of integrity of not ripping off other people's material. And what I'm needing to do is I need to find, and this is one of the things I wanted to ask the copyright people, is there a definitive resource that you can go to that will tell you absolutely who owns the copyright on a piece of literature, and how do you contact that person? Okay, accurate contact information. I don't know if such a resource exists. It needs to exist, because right now I'm running around like a chicken with my head cut off, and it's quite frustrating. But that's the situation I'm in right now. That I'm wanting to do this, because I've got my hand on the actual document, and it's become very clear to me that Connor's autism, as they like to say, the low functioning autistics, well, that's actually a extreme misnomer. If you actually read the document, it becomes very clear that when the American Psychiatric Association did the DSM defining autism, they cherry-picked his material. Okay, if you will take the time, to read through that material, he wasn't just pointing out all these negatives. He was pointing out that these children that he was seeing had superior ability for memorization. They were memorizing Psalms, poems, presidents of the United States, at extremely young ages. This one, that autistic number one, actually, well, here, I've got the document on my tablet here. Give me a minute. Okay, Donald T. Okay, well, is case number one. Okay, At the age of 1 year, he could hum and sing many tunes accurately. Before he was 2 years old, yet he had an unusual memory for faces and names, knew the names of a great number of houses in his hometown. He was encouraged by his family in learning and reciting short poems, even learned the 23rd Psalm and the 25 questions and answers of the Presbyterian Catechism. Keep in mind, this is all by the age of 2, before he turned 2 years old, okay? This is what's in Dr. Connor's material, you know, that is completely lost when we're talking about, you know, what Dr. Connor observed. He observed a lot of different positives. And then scrolling down to the end where he gives his summation of his, let's see here, of his a summation of his observations. Okay. 8 of the 11 children acquired the ability to speak either at an unusual age or after some delay. 3, Richard, Herbert, and Virginia, have so far remained mute. And none of the 8 speaking children has language over a period of years served to convey meaning to others that, okay, so yeah, that's going into some of their struggles. Okay, almost all parents reported unusual with much pride that their child had learned at an early age to repeat an inordinate number of nursery rhymes, prayers, lists of animals, the roster of presidents, the alphabet forward and backwards, even foreign language, French lullabies. Aside from the reciting of sentences contained in the ready-made poems or other remembered pieces, it took a long time for them to begin to put words together. Okay, so again, no, this, like I say, is a holistic understanding of autism. Okay, and this idea that Dr. Asperger, you know, was making all these positive, you know, observations, that he was seeing something completely different in his patients than what Dr. Connor was seeing in his is completely bogus, okay? This erroneous notion is a direct result of people not going to the source material and seeing what Dr. Connor wrote himself, and instead is relying upon other people's commentaries, in which many of these people, actually the status quo, has cherry-picked his material, focusing solely on the struggles. And the evidence is right there, okay? And you know, for you to read for yourself, you know, this isn't some hidden secrets, you know, whatever that I come across. No, this isn't a secret. It's been online since at least the time of my diagnosis, okay? It was written in a public journal for everybody to read it back in 1943, okay? And so it's out there, you know, you just have to decide that you're going to go to the source material and read the source material for yourself, instead of abdicating your responsibility to do your own homework to other people. You know, you need to do your own homework. Read the source material yourself instead of relying upon everybody else's commentaries, okay? And so this is what I'm wanting to do. And so the project that I'm kicking off, I'm calling the Connor Asperger Project. And what I'm wanting to do, you know, is starting with all the works of Doctors Connor and Asperger that we're able to get a hold of, you know, is to find out what the copyright issues are. If they are public domain, you know, that then we can, you know, have people like LibriVox, you know, go ahead and do the audio recording, because a number of the people, you know, that do the recordings for LibriVox are very interested in doing the recordings on this, and also a previous Connor work called In Defense of Mothers, defending them from overzealous psychology. That's the gist of the title, but you know, and and there's a lot of interest in doing these recordings if we can establish that they are public domain. Okay, if the copyright is still active, if Dr. Connor and Asperger willed their copyrights to some descendant or some organization or whoever, okay, we need to find out who these people are and contact them in order to see what we can do to get permission to release the original documents, okay? And in this case, of course, I'm not authorized to speak on LibriVox's behalf, but it's my understanding that this is the case that, they may be reluctant to touch it, because they're very, staunch about must be in the public domain, period. No other, discussions whatsoever, and so, if there is a need for us to obtain copyright permission, we may need another option other than LibriVox as far as doing recordings of these to put on the internet. But we can figure that out. It'll probably be a case by case basis as far as these documents go. And so one of the things is that for those who are really good readers, LibriVox might be a really good volunteer project for some people to get involved with, because right now they've got their own Gutenberg project, okay, which it is a list of public domain books started by this Gutenberg Foundation, and I'll include the links to all this with this video. But anyways, but they have all these public domain books that they're wanting to put out into the public, and LibriVox is teaming up with them to make audio recordings, audio books of all these public domain literature. And in fact, I first learned about LibriVox, wanting to look at U.S. historical documents, and I've got the Constitution, Federalist Papers, Anti-Federalist Papers. I've got historical documents that most people, myself included, didn't even know existed. Okay, and so so LibriVox is really good, and so that could be another project that's for some people who like to do reading, is so that way, when we do obtain the copyrights, we could definitely have people that are ready to do these readings. I won't have to search for people to do the readings. We'll already have volunteers lined up, but in any case, but like I said, I've already got a commitment from somebody to do the original Connor document, as well as his one on in defense of mothers. I actually had somebody commit to doing that before I ever mentioned doing anything beyond. So anyways, so this is this project that I'm wanting to kick off, and so I'm starting a meetup page, or not meetup, I'm sorry, a Facebook page, in order to for us to rendezvous together, as well as a blog site, for us to come together and to coordinate our research efforts, into finding finding the information in order to find out who has the copyrights and getting permission to use these copyrights. And once we do get the copyrights, we can put the information on our blog and the Facebook page, as well as like I said, just coordinating our efforts. And so anyways, I'm including the links to those two sources in the links attached to this video. So anyways, thank you, and I hope that that people will be able to contribute to this project, and because I really believe it will be very beneficial. So until then, have a good day.